So we are here to introduce to you a hero from Udupi, a very dynamic, efficient leader with political leanings too, and also the MD of Prasad Netralaya and member scientific committee AIRS, who is going to talk on a new frontier, presbyopia classic, a fairly untouched frontier as yet. On to you, Dr. Kudlu. Could you share your screen? Dr. Krishna Prasad?
Yeah, can you yes. See my slide, madam?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Once again, thank you so much, Chitra madam, for this wonderful opportunity. What a feeling to be in between the ERC panel. The first time, I think, I'm coming inside the ERC. Very much thankful to you, madam. So I'll be talking about the presbyopia classic, a new frontier. This is my financial disclosure. I'm consultant for Carl Zeiss India. So since the postgraduate students are the main listener for this particular program, so just wanted to tell about what exactly is the presbyopia, which is progressive loss of accommodation affecting individuals in their middle age, regardless of any underlying refract error, causing difficulty in sharply focusing for near vision. So there are different principles used to correct presbyopia. We used to do like monovision, that correcting one eye for distance and other eye for near, or even few of the excimer system, it do a multifocality treatment, or we used to even do increased depth of focus, what we do in camera inlays, or you can even try out for combined approaches. These are the options available in the overall options. With the lens procedures, you can opt for multifocal IOLs, trifocal IOLs. Nowadays, people are implanting extended range of vision IOLs. Coming to the corneal procedure, mainly presbylasic, presbyon, or even nowadays, one more popular the treatment is supracore, or the previous one was intracore. And even people been trying with a procedure called scleroceliary complex modification procedure. I'll not be talking about this procedure, especially laser rays, and also some of the people are trying with the scleral spacing device. So coming to one or two words about, even though my today mainstay of the treatment about the presbyelastic, but I just wanted to touch upon one or two words about the corneal inlays. The most popular one is camera inlays. Normally we have to implant in the non-dominant eye, that increases the depth of focus almost, which is similar to the pinhole. How you make the LASIK flap, you have to insert underneath the LASIK flap. So I'm not talking about how exactly this is done. And there are other corneal inlays also available in the market, that is presbya. The principle is similar to that. The raindrop has been a little bit popular in some of the countries where they do a reshaping inlay where it shapens the corneal curvature. But these are the few problems with corneal inlays. Definitely there is a reduction in the distance vision in the non-dominant eye, some amount of glare and halos with some amount of reduction in the contrast sensitivity. So let me come to the presbylasic. It is a multifocal LASIK treatment, which is a biaspheric treatment. Here, what we induce as a spherical aberration for depth of field. So in that, there are two components, peripheral presbylasic. What happens there? The peripheral, the central zone is corrected for far vision, peripheral myopic ring created for near vision. Sometimes you can reverse this treatment also. So this is the central presbylasic, because I don't have much idea about presbylasic. What we do in the central presbylasic, central steep zone for near vision, whenever the pupil is constricting and more physiological, and normally they'll have a stronger reading power. Especially these treatments do very well with the hyperopic patients. Coming to the presbymasic, actually presbyelastic normally used to do with the older version of the few of the excimer system with the Allegretto system. Now some of them, I think machine has come in something called presbymax. I think my friend Dr. Rohit has been doing in Narayan Netralaya with the Swin machine. It's nothing but a biaspheric multifocal ablation. So what they do, the dominant eye is focused slightly more for distance and the non-dominant eye slightly more for the near. So even AMO also come with the, some of the concept. Previously they used to try with the physics machine where they steepen the central zone for near vision and leaves the periphery for distance. So especially it is these treatments are people used to do more in the hyperopic patients. So these are a few problems with the presbyelastic. Initially compromise of especially for distance vision, patients used to get adjusted for till the 3 months. Adaptation is the problems, and some of the patient even complaining of night vision problems. So coming to the supracord, probably this is the latest of all, which is LASIK based procedure, which is performed on the Technolos 217 excimer laser system. So what exactly they do in the supracord? It creates an elevation of 12 micron high, 3 micron in 3 mm in diameter in the central cornea along with the visual axis. So this is the sort of a varifocal principle that allows simultaneous good distance, intermediate and near vision. So this was the previously they used to do something treatment called intracore. So with the help of Technolos machine. So it is performed in the stroma as a flapless procedure, but nowadays people stop doing this intracore treatment. What exactly they do here, they steepen the cornea by approximately 1 diopter. So changes in the biomechanics that produce the myopic shift approximately around 0.5 diopter. Here also the concept is same. Here it induces the negative spherical aberration. So the one more most popular treatment, I think probably one of our chief panelists also undergone this treatment, that is Presbyon, Dr. Sri Ganesh undergone this treatment. So this, what exactly we do here? Before treatment, I just wanted to tell for postgraduate student, refraction is the key, like any of the refractive treatment. So I do for every patient cyclopegic refraction, whether they are myopic or hypermetropic patient. Once you are refraction done properly, then very important to know which is the dominant eye. Once you know the dominant eye, then you have to trial the micromonovision testing by making the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 diopters. So it's very simple. If when you're doing this micromonovision testing, suppose any patient complained of cross blur, then these are the patient actually they don't do well after the treatment. You can repeat this micromonovision testing 2 times or 3 times. Still, if the patient say that I'm having double vision, I'm having blurred vision, then you should not pick them for Presbyon treatment. Then remaining is routine pre-LASIK evaluation. Normally the software which is given by the ZEISS, that is CRS master, that will decide the treatment. You can do this treatment either their old version excimer system, that is MEL 80 or MEL 90. So why we actually, what exactly we do here in this, we make dominant eye emmetropic and make the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 diopters. Along with that, we create a spherical aberration in both the corneas. As I said that we make the dominant eye emmetropic and make the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 diopters with some amount of spherical aberration in both the cornea. Then we'll have something called blend zone like this. The blend zone is the zone where the vision from both dominant and the non-dominant eye meets up and binocularity retains. So this is about the principles of Presbyon. It, as I said that, it is a principle of monovision with the increased depth of focus, spherical aberration control, neural separation and blur adaptation. I just want to tell you a few words about why we pick this treatment, because if you do a rings in the cornea for both for distance and near, normally patient gets a lot of time to get adjusted. So the overall adaptation time takes very longer period. Coming to the, that's what I was telling you, how we used to like a suppress. If you can imagine about the children with how you're treating amblyopia, always the one eye will be like a blood from the other eye. This is how the concept behind this treatment. According to few of our senior surgeon, what they say that, see, I've been doing almost around 500 surgeries so far, 97% of the patient always wanted this treatment. Only thing is your pre-op evaluation is very, very important. So coming to the, what are the best points about Presbyon? It's not depend upon the pupil size. You can do extremes of power. I have done up to 5 diopters hypermetropic. I have done myopic up to around 8 diopters, depending upon the PACI value. Even up to the astigmatism, I'm around 3 diopters. All my patients had a very good intermediate and near vision. And around, as I said before, more than 97% of the patients adopt this treatment really well and without any significant night vision problems and contrast sensitivity changes. So coming to the, which is the best option? So if you think about, okay, multifocal, I'm adding here multifocal IOLs also, because now most of us been implanting this trifocal lens. If you think about distance vision, intermediate vision, near vision, night vision problem, pupil dependent, and adaptation reversibility. If you think about all this procedure, multifocal IOLs, corneal inlays, presbyelastic, supracore, definitely presbyond has got a very good distance, very good intermediate vision, very good near vision, no night vision dependent problem. And very important, it is independent of pupil also, faster adaptation. And of course, if any chance, any patient come back to you, if they're not getting adjusted, you can reverse this treatment. So in the probably the best and the safest presbyopic treatment available till date. Once again, I thank Chitra Madam and the whole ARC team for this wonderful opportunity. Thank you one and all.
Thanks, Dr. Krishna Prasad. You really gave us a very crisp and clear picture, and I'm sure the postgraduates would have learned the essential concept of presbyopic lensing. Dr. Sri Ganesh, are you there?
Yes, I am here.
Could you ask, take the questions for presbyopia classic, because you are very much into it?
Yes, I myself have undergone presbyopia classic and presbyon, and I have done most of those presbyopia corrections from CK to presbymax, multifocal treatments, presbyon. So I have assessed most of them, and then finally I decided to undergo presbyon. One of the questions that I wanted to ask is, see, in multifocal, when you create a multifocal ablation on the cornea and ridges on the cornea, the epithelium has a natural tendency to, as a masking agent, and it smooths any irregularity in the cornea by relatively becoming thick or thin. So this ridges which you cause, the multifocality on the cornea, doesn't really last for a long time. If you do the topography and if you look at the epithelial maps, in a couple of months, basically the epithelium heals and then it becomes, it smoothens over. So again, this effect would not last for a long time. So you have quite a bit of regression in these procedures. Plus the other thing is, because of the multifocality, the night vision is quite poor. You get loss of best corrected vision. So this is something which is interesting to study, and in fact ask Dr. Rohit also if he has done epithelial maps for his press patients, and what does he see?
But what happens is, you're absolutely right, if the epithelium is irregular prior to doing your surgery, the epithelium model remodeling is going to be very aggressive. So this is one of the tests we consider before we do a presbyopic surgery, to look at the epithelial maps. If you have a donut shape, irregular epithelium, and there's a lot of difference in epithelium in the central 6 millimeter zone, then your post-operative will also become very irregular. The reason epithelium is very irregular is for two reasons. One is their ocular surface is bad. Epithelium being irregular is ocular surface bad. So it also gives you an indirect indication that if your ocular surface is bad, the healing post-op, like you mentioned yourself, is going to be terribly bad. So I'm sure that one of the two important things, apart from what Sir Kudlu sir mentioned, is the role of epithelium. The epithelium integrity before surgery is a direct predictor of what happens post-operatively. So if it is not very healthy, then I would give her at least 4 months time. I do what a lippy flow or eye light, one of these procedures. We put them on cyclosporin and trehalose. Trehalose is because trehalose is a direct relation to epithelial apoptosis. So after 3 to 4 months time, you see a very uniform epithelial remodeling. And then you do it, and then they do much better. That is something which
No, but you can't actually see the multifocality on the topography because the epithelium kind of masks it.
Mask, absolutely. Post-operative.
Most of the refraction takes place at the air epithelial interface. Between the epithelium and the stroma where the ridges are, there's not much of difference in the refractive index. So you don't get that much of an effect. And even if the effect is there, then it is unpleasant for the patient because some of them are not able to tolerate this multifocality. And that's where most of these multifocal treatments actually failed. And most of them are kind of reversing to reducing the amount of multifocality and more towards a micro monovision kind of. Even I think PresbyMax now, the latest software, they have reduced the multifocality and then they are going more towards the micro monovision and induction of spherical aberration, similar to the PresBeyond software.
One thing I would like to add, what Dr. Kudlu said is, the most important thing in presbyopic evaluation is role of orthoptics and binocular single vision. If the patients have poor accommodation of convergence, they would really have a lot of problems. So evaluating that, treating that with exercises, home and office based, and then doing the procedure would be one of the points to be added.
And along with that, Rohit, I think we need to do eye trace also just to make sure that patient doesn't have cataract. Sometimes whatever the slit lamp examination, we miss that, then in the end you land up in a problem.
Dr. Kudlu, what is for the audience, I think you can clarify, what is the difference between PresBeyond and laser blended vision? Because there is usually confusion and many of them use these terms interchangeably.
So yeah, I don't think the postgraduates will understand because even for the experts it is, but I think you can clarify, Kudlu.
No, maybe we could take it up later. We go on to our next speakers, that particular issue, because I think this topic would get a little beyond what the postgraduates are going to understand. Thank you so much, Krishna Prasad. We really got a very good clarity about the essential things we need to understand as to why presbyopia classic has come into vogue with the limitations which are there in the different processes. Thank you very much.